Okay, so I had prepared this talk long ago. Basically, what I do is I talk about the physics of semiconductors, then take you from the bulk to the nanoscale, and then I give some examples of semiconducting nanostructures. Then talk about some of the phenomena. And some of these phenomena, in fact, we are going to look at in this course. Okay, for example, that quantized conductance phenomenon that we had just finished in the last class, we will recapitulate that. And then some of the devices, and then what is the outlook. So start with let's say some semiconductors, and then I mean all of these things you are familiar with. This is conductivity, this is or resistivity. If you look at the conductivity, then this is resistance versus temperature, and for a conductor it increases with temperature, whereas for a semiconductor or insulator it decreases. Okay, so again, everybody is familiar with this kind of dependence and activation activated temperature dependence. And this is basically the band structure, that there is a conduction band, there is a valence band, and you can have a, this is just a schematic, okay? But if you look at real band structure, this is also something that we saw. You can have either a direct band gap or an indirect band gap, okay? And you can get a lot of tunability if you dope the
Sir,
system. Yeah.
please cut the format options, then the picture will be large enough.
Oh yeah, sure. Sorry, I should have done a full screen. Can you see it now?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah.
It's
I
fine.
should have done full screen. Okay. So basically, you can get a lot of tunability if you dope the system. So this is P-doped. Okay. And you can see that the resistivity changes drastically. So if you look at the bulk systems, they look like this. But when you start, making nano systems of nanocrystals of these materials, they look extremely different, right? So this is, for example, one silicon nanocrystal, okay, and the size of this is about 2 nanometers, and these molecules that you see outside, these are actually cyclohexane, okay, and the reason you need to cap these, this is called capping, okay, capping of a silicon nanocrystal, and the reason you have to cap these is because if you don't cap them, then all of these nanocrystals will coagulate, okay, they'll get together. And when they get together, you can't have individual nanocrystal properties. Okay, confinement is lost. The quantum confinement that you get by having a nanocrystal, that is lost. And on the right side, this is a high-resolution transmission electron microscope. Okay, of a single silicon nanoparticle. So the blur thing that you see in the background, right? That is the substrate. Okay, so it's blurred because it is out of focus. And here you see. There is a kind of a structure that you can make out where there are very clean layers. Okay, so this is a real space image of a single silicon nanoparticle, which is the schematic of which is drawn here on the left-hand side. Okay, and these are developed by National Institute of Standards and Technology, US. So where they have they basically create standard things. Okay, so here. They, in this particular article, they claim that they have created a whole bunch of standard 2 nanometer silicon nanoparticles. When you create nanoparticles, you don't have a control over the size, okay? But these guys claim to have created claim to have full control over the size of the silicon nanoparticle, and they have, they sell these. So you can buy 2 nanometer silicon nanocrystals, 3 nanometers, 10 nanometers, and so on, okay? So what I'm trying to say here is that if you go from bulk to the nanoscale, the properties change completely, and silicon doesn't remain silicon as we know it, or gold doesn't remain gold as we know it. And most of you would have seen this picture where the silicon nanocrystals can give you completely different colors. In fact, the same thing happens with gold also. The gold nanocrystals also give you completely different colors depending on the size of the nanocrystals, okay? And these are all subjected to UV light. So the question is, can this be understood with very simple arguments? And what we will see is that if you just use a particle in a box argument, you can actually understand this behavior. And so let me show you some more pictures. This is a silicon nanowire, and this appeared in 2003. So this is a 22 nanometer silicon nanowire. Okay, and this here in the inset, you see the diffraction pattern. It's very, very clean. Okay, very clean crystalline. And what you see on the right-hand side is a scanning electron microscope image of a silicon nanowire forest. Okay, the reason they want to do this is that if you look at the silicon substrate, right, on the silicon substrate they have grown these nanowires, right? The length of these nanowires is around 35 microns, okay, and the width of each of these nanowires is roughly about 22 nanometers, the diameter. So you can see the aspect ratio is huge, right? Microns to nanos, that is about 1000. Okay, and the reason they want to do this is because in the silicon substrate, which may be used, for example, for building a chip, okay, which, and the chips can get very hot, right? So one would want to, for example, take away the heat which is produced in certain hot spots, and that can damage the chip. So they have built these silicon nanowire forests, and on the top here, right, you can see these flower like objects. And these broccoli or cauliflower like objects are actually porous copper layer. Okay, and that's a top contact. So from this top contact, which is a porous copper layer, you will take out the heat that is coming out of the chip. Okay, so this kind of a thing is possible now. So you can build this forest of silicon nanowires. Okay, then here I'm showing you on the left hand side, you see there is a quantum ring. And this quantum ring can be made very, very small. In fact, people have built rings of just 10 atoms. Okay, this is, of course, a much bigger ring. This is nano sized ring. And you will see that there is a particular effect that we will talk about. It's called the Aronoff-Bohm effect. And that can be observed in these kind of quantum ring structures. Okay, on the right hand side, this is a quantum dot. And what you see here on the left is actually height versus distance. Okay, so you see that there is a the height is, or the profile of this quantum dot is roughly about, is roughly like a parabolic. Okay, but if you look at the second one, which is grown slightly differently on a different surface or on a different, you can see there is a 1 1 bar 0 and a 1 1 0. Okay, and the profile of these two quantum dots is not the same. Okay, that you can see from here. This is rounded and this is much more conical, right? And you can take these quantum dots and make them self-assemble on a different substrate. So this is a whole collection of self-assembled quantum dots. Okay, so you don't have to, you know, engineer them by putting them in specific places. They automatically go and grow somewhere and then sit somewhere. They have some they can do a self-assembly of their arrangement. Then from in JNC, if you spend 1 or 2 years and attend the talks and seminars, you will see a lot of images. Okay, because in JNC, microscopy is taken extremely seriously, and we have state of the art transmission electron microscope, scanning electron microscope, and all kinds of things. Okay, atomic force microscope, magnetic force microscope, you name it, and we will most likely have it. So this is from Professor Rao's lab. These are tungsten disulfide nano sheets, and basically the idea is that when you can have graphene as a 2D material, but analogous to graphene, you can have many other inorganic materials also, like molybdenum disulfide, tungsten disulfide, and so on. And what you see here in the top panel is just the image of that, and then this is probably the SEM image because this is 500 nanometers. And on the lower panel, you see a high resolution transmission electron microscope image, okay, because this, the scale here is 2 nanometers. So here you see atomic resolution, and here you don't see atomic resolution, but you can see the shapes of these nano sheets. Now in Professor Shiv Prasad's lab, they have a molecular beam epitaxy machine where you can take or where you can build materials layer by layer, okay, single layer by single layer. So what you see here is again a scanning electron microscope image of a gallium nitride nano walls, right? You're seeing here the top view, and the scale is 100 nanometers. Okay, so these nano walls turn out to have very interesting properties and very unlike the bulk gallium nitride. Okay, so the kind of shape you make of these materials, the property of that material changes very drastically depending on the shape of that material. Okay, then in Professor Sundaresh's and Professor Ishwarmurthy's collaboration, they built something called nano cups made out of Fe2O3. Okay, but I think they also called it femto cups because these femto cups, the volume that they could hold was around femtoliters. And in this histogram, what is shown is again these the nanowall length profile. Okay, so if you look at if you just count how many nanowalls have a length of 300 nanometer, right? That would be around 9. So if you take very long nanowalls, there will be very few. If you take very short nanowalls, again there will be very few. Okay, so this is all from JNC, and this is a very, very small subset of the kind of things that goes on in JNC. There are a lot of nano science and nanotechnology kind of things that goes on in JNC. Okay, so I would really encourage you to go into different labs and see their posters and other kinds of things. Then this is another kind of a semiconducting nanostructure. It's called a quantum well structure. So what you can do here is that you can build these layers, and then in between the layers, you can give spacers, okay? And these spacers are something like sapphire or some kind of a high-k dielectric, which prohibits conduction between these different layers, okay? And what you see here inside in this image are the actual images, microscopic images of these multiple quantum wall structures. And what this enables you to do is mentioned here. It's a single chip, super broadband, indium gallium nitride, gallium nitride LED, light emitting device, enabled by nanostructured substrate. Okay, so what does broadband mean? See, usually if you have a single quantum well structure, then what happens is you have a certain band gap or you have a certain band structure, right? But when you create this nanostructured substrate with different kinds of dopings and different kinds of materials, then you can create a tandem structure where there are different band gaps and different band structures all in one single chip. Okay, so there, when the electrons and holes, they combine together to emit light, since the energies are different, the band structures are different, you can extract different colors, and by combining these different quantum wells, you can get a broadband light emitting device. Okay, so that's again something that is done using nanostructuring. Then this is actually the scanning electron microscope image of the Intel's 22 nanometer Trigate device. Okay, now it's very hard to figure out actually where this transistor is, but you can make out roughly. Okay, there is a source here, there is a drain here, and then there is a metal gate, right? And the gate length is actually, the scale is mentioned here, but I can't see it. I'm sure, well, the sizes are mentioned here. You can see average fin width is 18 nanometer, average fin height is 35, fin pitch is 60, and so on. And if you look at the real image, this is just a schematic. The real image looks like this, okay? And I tried very hard to make a correspondence of this real image with this schematic, but I could not do it, okay? But basically, this is actually the Intel Broadwell architecture, which has been used, I think, in either 7th or 8th generation Core i5 and i7 processors, okay, which many of us are still using. And you should really appreciate that there are about 2.5 billion transistors on a 1-inch by 1-inch silicon wafer, or even smaller than that, okay? And this is 14 nanometer technology. So this is a movie, okay? And in this movie, what we will do, I mean, what these guys have done is to, just 1 minute. So in this movie, what these guys have done is they have taken they have zoomed into a chip, okay, into a microscopic chip. And what I'll do is I'll just speed it up. Oops. Okay, let it play. Yeah. So they're zoomed into this microchip, okay? And what you should see finally is this actual structure of the transistors placed together. You should see how dense it is. By the way, can you all hear me?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
So this is a 1 millimeter scale, and then so you see, these are all contacts. Okay. Contacts between different transistors. So this is a 6 micron scale. 1 micron. So each square represents a 20 nanometer transistor. Okay. So basically what they're saying is a 20 nanometer transistor roughly takes about a 1 micron by 1 micron space. Okay. So, and there are many such videos on YouTube. You should take a look at those where Intel shows you, for example, there is a video called From Sand to Silicon or From Sand to a Chip or something like that. Okay. Where they show you how they make the silicon ingot, how they cut silicon wafers, and then how they have a blueprint to make these, very large scale integrated devices. Okay, it's called VLSI technology. So basically this was again a very elementary talk. So I started with the Schrodinger's equation, and then I said that at the quantum scale, you have quantum confinement, then tunneling, quantization, enhanced surface effects, then quantum interference effects, and universal magnetism. So again, all of this, you guys definitely know this. So there is quantum confinement at the nanoscale, and this can be understood using this particle in a box. So we know that the energy levels are basically discrete at the nanoscale, right? And each of these levels have a certain wave function. So now here, if you look at the levels that have been shown here, you see that there is a 111 here. This is a 3D box, okay? 3D particle in a box problem. If you solve it, you will get 111 as the lowest level, and then you can have a 121, 112, 211, triply degenerate level, and the energy is E0, 6E0, 9E0, 11, 12, 14, and 17. Okay, so these are the different energy levels. Now, this is what can be used to understand that that picture I showed you of silicon showing you different colors when it is made in different sizes. Okay, so how do we understand that? If you see here, there is a size that has been decreased. Okay, 6 nanometer all the way to 2 nanometer, right? So these the 6 nanometer silicon nanocrystals or colloidal semiconductor nanocrystals, I don't know exactly whether it is silicon or whatever, but if you take 6 nanometer crystals, they will show you this color, and 2 nanometers will show you bluish color. Okay, so what you need to appreciate is that as you are decreasing the size, the color, the frequency is actually increasing. Okay, the wavelength is decreasing, right? You're going from red to blue. What that means is that the energy corresponding to the photons is actually increasing, that is being emitted, which means that the gap, the band gap, must be increasing. Okay, so one thing to remember is that quantum confinement makes the levels discrete and increases the band gap. Okay, so size, changing the size implies a tunability of the band structure, right? So here you see for the 6 nanometer, the band structure looks something like this. Okay, the conduction band is here, the valence band is here, and this is the band gap. And what you see here are either impurity levels or the subbands. And as you're decreasing the size, you can see that the band gap is increasing. Okay, and the levels are becoming more and more discrete, right? So this kind of a change in the band gap is what is responsible for the different colors. Okay, and this tunability can be achieved by tuning the size of the nanoparticles. Okay, then
sir,
yeah,
sir, can you just show the previous slide? I have a question.
Yeah,
sir, here the red, yellow, green, all they are the nanoparticles, but when we derive the energy band structure, that means a conduction band or valence band, we do the calculations for the constituent atoms and the solid, then
yeah.
How the particle size decreasing the particle size, increasing the energy band gap, because here the total particle is not, if we consider the total nanoparticle as a single particle, then I understand this. But when we assume the band structure or write the band structure or derive the band structure for a particular solid of different size, then how can proceed?
Correct. So what is being shown here, okay, is not the actual band structure. See, if you look at the particle in a box problem, in the particle in a box problem, if you start writing down the energy levels, right, you see here there is a L here, okay, this L is basically decreasing,
yes,
right?
Yes sir, so, I understood L decreasing and total energy is increasing.
Correct. Now what I showed you in the okay, so what you're seeing here is basically the that if you start from some level and then you go on increasing N, then basically the discreteness becomes a continuum. Okay, now I think maybe this valence band and conduction band is probably misleading. What I would think is happening here is that if you just take N equal to 1, 2, 3 and N is, this is of course a 1D box, but if you generalize it to a 3D box and have a NX squared plus NY squared plus NZ squared, then you will only get the top picture, the top part, okay? And in the top part, you can again see that the level spacing is different. And maybe what is, you know, there are certain matrix elements connecting the different levels, and the transitions that happen also depend on those matrix elements, right? So the electronic transitions. Some might be more favorable, some might be less favorable. So what I think is happening in these silicon nanocrystals is, of course, a bulk picture is invalid. Okay, I completely agree with that. You have to have a purely quantum picture, and the best or the simplest model of understanding a nanocrystal is basically particle in a box. Okay.
Okay, sir.
And for that particle in a box, I think the upper half is what we need to focus on. Okay, forget the lower half. I don't think there is anything like a conduction band and a valence band in these sizes of quantum dots. We can't apply a bulk picture. This is not, there is no K space picture that we can apply here. Okay, sir.
That means in nanostructure, the band structure, how we derived before, it is not absolutely valid. As we decrease the size, then. The more problem is coming.
Correct, because in the nanocrystal, certainly the Bloch's theorem will not be valid, right?
Yeah, the periodicity, because there will be periodic boundary condition will not be valid.
Periodic boundary condition is not valid, and open boundary condition would be valid. But then for open boundary conditions, you can't have, in fact, if you look at the crystal structure of these nanoparticles, you will actually see certain subtle differences with respect to the lattice parameter and even the structure as corresponds to the bulk structure. In fact, as you go to smaller and smaller sizes, there is something called magic numbers, which means that only certain number of atoms will cluster together. Okay, and those are not even called nanocrystals. They are actually called, what is it called? I think atomic clusters or something, where very few atoms come together, okay? And their structure is very different from what you see in the bulk, okay? When you take a bulk crystal and look at it using X-ray diffraction, you will get a certain structure, maybe FCC, BCC or whatever. But when you take these magic number clusters, you will see a completely different structure, okay? So even the structure actually evolves as you go from the nanoscale all the way to the bulk, right? The energy level structure evolves, the real space structure evolves, and so on. And this is a kind of a length scale where periodic boundary conditions are definitely not valid. But to be fair, even the particle in a box is not really valid. Okay? Because if you look at it closely, there are actually atoms sitting inside. Okay? And it's not as if it's just a shell with nothing inside. See, when we take particle in a box, we are just saying that there is an outer potential and inside the electrons are completely free. Okay, that's basically the particle in a box problem, right? But here, it's not only that. Inside the crystal, inside the nanocrystal, there are atoms sitting there. So the potential profile is actually very complicated. And to find the energy level structure of that complicated system can take you, you know, months on the biggest supercomputers. To solve the energy level structure of that six nanometer crystal is probably, you know, I don't even know whether it's possible currently. Okay, so that's why we do very simple level modeling, and particle in a box serves as a very good model. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Okay, I understood.
Yeah. And then this is a two-dimensional electron gas. So something we have discussed earlier, where you know, in this two-dimensional electron gas, if you turn on a perpendicular magnetic field, you see the quantum Hall effect. Okay. And how is this 2D electron gas created? Again, it's created using this nanostructure. So there is a drain here, there is a source here. This is the aluminium gallium nitride. This is the channel. This is the device. And there is a gate here, and there is a gallium nitride here. Okay. So what you can see is that the 2D electron gas is forming at the interface between the channel and the gallium nitride. Okay. Between this semiconductor substrate and this channel. So that's where the 2D electron gas forms. Okay. And this high mobility electron transistor, I will show you later, is actually used in many, many different applications. But it's also useful for fundamental science, because the quantum Hall effect is a very fundamental phenomenon. Okay. And I don't know how many of you know this, but the quantum Hall effect was one of the first phenomena where topology entered condensed matter physics. Okay. And very recently, the Nobel Prize was also given for topological, for investigations of topological phenomena in condensed matter physics. Then, so this is something that we had looked at last time. Okay, I had shown you conductance steps, right? And I told you that the conductance steps can be observed in quantum point contacts. Now, what are quantum point contacts? Okay, so that is something you might imagine, you know, two wires touching each other. Okay, and I will show you pictures of those also. But this is a particular quantum point contact where something very interesting was shown. Okay. This is a paper which was published in 2014 in Applied Physics Letters, and the title is "The Features of Ballistic Electron Transport in a Suspended Quantum Point Contact." Okay, so what they are considering here is that they make a quantum point contact, and I'll explain to you how they made it. Once they made the quantum point contact, it could be made either sitting on a substrate or in a suspended way, where there was no substrate at the bottom. Okay, so it was completely suspended. And what they saw was that the conductance quantization is actually different for a quantum point contact sitting on a substrate versus a suspended quantum point contact. Okay, and I'll show you the data also, but let me explain to you how they made this quantum point contact. So you see here, there is a gate. This is gate one, and this is gate two, and this is source, and this is drain, right? So the transport is happening like this, source to drain, okay? And this region here, right? This region here, which is between this corner and between this corner, that is where the contact is. This is the quantum point contact, okay? And how do you control this quantum point contact? So let me tell you about the length scales also. The length here is about 800 nanometers, okay? It's quite large, right? It's about 0.8 microns. And this gap here, the gap between the gate and the source and drain, is about 100 nanometers. Okay. So remember, the gate is not touching this, right? So this gate is also not touching this. So there are two gates using which you can control the confinement properties of the point contact. And you can apply a source drain voltage, which will give you the conductance of this quantum point contact. Okay. So with this structure, with this quantum point contact, if you look in the if you look at the bottom here, which is not visible, of course, but there is a substrate. And what they could do in this experiment was to etch out that substrate and make it suspended, make the QPC suspended. Okay, so they did both of these experiments, and what they found was this. So what you see here is conductance in units of 2E squared by H. This is before suspension. Okay. And this is gate voltage. So they are tuning the gate voltage to see these different steps, right? Let me go back and show you what is happening. This is gate one, this is gate two. So if you tune the gate voltage, you can tune the confinement properties. Okay, lower the gate voltage, larger is the contact, right? Higher the gate voltage, more is the confinement. Okay, so what you see here is that if you go on increasing the gate voltage, you're increasing the confinement and the number of channels are reducing drastically. Okay, so this is 1 into 2 E squared by H, this is 2 into 2 E squared by H, and so on. Okay, but then after suspension, they found something interesting. Okay, you see there is a 1.5, there is a plateau at 1.5. Okay, but interestingly, what they saw was that if they zoomed on this region, they found a plateau at 0.7. Okay, not here actually, somewhere here. Okay, this was 0.7. And this was very interesting because what they could show was that the system is not completely ballistic. So, okay, let me go back. What I told you was that in a quantum point contact, the electrons can zip through as if there was no scattering. Okay, and if you remember the algebra that we did last time, we had taken a particle in a box or a wire actually, and we had confined the wire along the xy plane, and the wire was extended along the z direction. When we constricted the wire along the x and y planes, along the x and y directions, the band structure got seriously discrete, okay? But the band structure was continuous in the z direction. So the kz was still continuous, but the kx and ky became really discrete. And because of that, we saw subbands emerging, okay? And when fewer and fewer subbands are between the mu l and mu r, the mu l is the left side chemical potential, mu r is the right side chemical potential, you can think of it as source and drain. So when fewer and fewer levels are between those two, you will see the conductance quantization because each subband carries only a fixed amount of current. Okay, so that was the origin of the conductance quantization. But if you observe a quantization at some fraction, okay, what that means is electron-electron interactions are actually playing an important role. Okay, and when electron-electron interactions are playing an important role, solving a single particle Schrodinger's equation is not sufficient. Okay, what do I mean by that? So we got those energy levels of the particle in a box problem by solving a single particle Schrodinger's equation. But if electron-electron interactions are important, you have to take into account these interactions, and then you have to solve a many-body Schrodinger's equation. Okay, and in that case, the density of states changes, the formula that we use for calculating conductance changes, and that's when you can get plateaus at different numbers, okay, at different fractions. So, and we will again look at that conductance quantization. So basically, physics at the nanoscale involves quantum confinement, and what I showed you was 2D nanostructures, super lattices in that quantum well structure, then quantum wires and quantum dots, right? And this is an analogy to understand quantum tunneling. So a bullet is not able to penetrate a wall, and if you give it sufficient energy, it would be able to penetrate. Okay, but this is this is actually not quantum tunneling. Okay, quantum tunneling can be observed in this video, where this magician, okay, Dynamo, he shows you some kind of a tunneling effect. There is a glass wall behind him. There is a glass door behind him. And what he will show you is that he can go through the glass door without breaking the glass door. Okay, so he comes up on the other side. So this is actually, obviously this is some kind of a trick that he has played on the audience. But what it shows is that quantum tunneling implies that electrons can go through barriers without destroying them, right? And that is the essence of quantum tunneling. And using the scanning tunneling microscope, you can see even atomic resolution images. And with the high resolution transmission electron microscope, you can see even sub-angstrom images. Okay, and these are some images that I have shown you very early on called quantum corals. Then Because you when you create nanocrystal, the surface to volume ratio increases drastically. You can use them for catalysis, water treatment and desalination, and you can also functionalize. What I mean by functionalize is that you can take these nanocrystals and then attach certain molecules on top of these nanocrystals. Okay, and one of the topics for presentation is actually surface enhanced Raman scattering. So there also there is a term called surface enhanced, right? So you use nanocrystals and you enhance the electric fields at the surface of these nanocrystals, because of which you can see an enhanced Raman effect. Okay, then in fact this kind of application was used by a group, by two groups in JNC. Okay, Professor Ishwar Murthy and Tapas Kundu from MBGU, they got together and they showed that there were certain nanocrystals that they could make which could hold the drug. Okay, and this drug was used for treating some brain disease. I don't remember which one, but usually what happens is if you want to treat any brain disease, there is a big problem because the brain has a blood-brain barrier. Okay, because of which most medicines are not able to penetrate that. But using these nanocrystals which held the drug, this nanoparticle could actually penetrate the blood-brain barrier. Okay, that's what they could show. So this was demonstrated. And then this is the quantum interference effect, where this is something that we will be discussing. So let me not go into this. Wanted to show you some applications also. So this is a quantum LED display. This has already come into the market. You can see this. Then quantum dot applications. There are, okay, so this is a very interesting application in photovoltaics. It turns out that if you take one photon, okay, and hit it, and that photon hits silicon, right? So then one photon can create one electron hole pair, which is called an exciton. Okay, but it turns out that if you use quantum dots, you can actually beat this Shockley-Quasar limit. So what happens is you can use one photon and create all the way up to 7 excitons. Okay, so one photon creating 7 excitons is really exciting, because using a single photon, you can create 7 electron hole pairs. And if you separate them out, then you have got 7 times the current. Okay, so this way you can imagine increasing the efficiency of solar cells to a really large number. Okay, and usually the Shockley-Quasar limit for photovoltaic efficiency is very low. It's about 22 or 25% or something. But using this multiple exciton generation, and also using tandem solar cell technology, where you take different semiconductors and make layers of them. Okay, so using those, people have reached efficiencies of the order of 42 to 50%. Okay, but they are used only in space applications and other places where the cost is not a limitation. But in most commercial installations, you only have silicon or amorphous silicon or polycrystalline silicon. Then quantum dots are also heavily used in biology, right? Then in light emitting diodes, I showed you the QLED displays. Then in quantum computing, silicon quantum dots have been proposed as qubits. Okay, then many other applications also. And then quantum wells also have a lot of applications in infrared photodetector, lasers, and also in the high electron mobility transistor, which I showed you for the 2D electron gas. And that is used in cell phones, satellite communications, and many other communication devices. Then nanowires have a lot of potential applications. And this is something that I don't know how many of these applications have actually been realized. But exceptionally small electronic circuits, for example, memory devices, transistors, advanced composite materials. This has already been realized. Okay, advanced composite materials, where nano wires or nano objects have been embedded in bulk, so that you can increase the strength, okay, and the flexibility both. Then quantum devices, biomolecular nanosensors. This is nano electromechanical sensors, I think. Then optoelectronics and so on. And then in JNC also there are at least three very important discoveries. One was by Professor Umesh Vagmare's group, where they showed where they predicted the world's thinnest ferroelectric. Okay, and it was actually realized. few years later. This was published in 2014. Then in 2006, Professor Sundareshan and Professor CNR Rao showed that if you create nanoparticles, then even though the system might be completely paramagnetic in bulk, for example, you can take copper, you can take gold, you can take any material which is non-magnetic in the bulk, but if you create nanoparticles, then you will get ferromagnetism. Okay, so the title itself said ferromagnetism as a universal feature of nanoparticles of the otherwise non-magnetic oxides. So what we discussed in the very beginning was that as you decrease the size of a system, you can see changes in the electronic structure. You can see changes in the real space structure, right? Real space lattice structure. But you can also see a change in the magnetic structure. That is what this paper showed. Okay. And not only change in the magnetic structure, they showed that these nanoparticles are ferromagnetic, okay, not any kind of magnetism. They are specifically ferromagnetic. And finally, there is a company that is a spin-off of JNC. This company belongs to Sebastian Peter and Umesh Vagmare, and Rakshit was a former student of EMU in JNC. And they have been able to find nanocatalysts for carbon dioxide sequestration. Okay, so basically converting carbon dioxide into methanol. And they have been they have been selected as finalists in the X Prize. So its X Prize is, I think, a $20 million prize. So they are finalists, means that they have gone through the semifinals and they have won $5 million. And now they are in the final stage where they have to actually demonstrate a working facility, okay, which converts, I think, about 400 kilogram of carbon dioxide into methanol every day. So that is, I think, the limit that I believe that's the limit that they have to demonstrate, and they are well on their way to do that. Okay, there is a different campus of JNC. I don't know how many of you know this, but it's called Chamundi campus. And in that campus, Sebastian has set up a factory. Okay, and that's where they are going. They are actually doing this demonstration. And very recently, they have achieved, I'm not sure how much, but maybe 100 kg or something, or maybe less than that. Right. So, but they are the finalists. So this is again using nanocatalysts. Right. So anyway. So I hope this was informative to some of you. Some of you might have already seen this and may not be very interesting, but I thought putting it together, it's actually gives an impact. So did you enjoy it? Well, you will say yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is there anybody who did not enjoy it? Was it boring? No? Good. Okay.
It was interesting.
Sir?
So some of the images, I'm sure you might not have seen, right?
Yes, sir. Sir, yeah. In few images, they were showing a plane and there were specific points indicating black. Sir, is that a void?
Oh, you mean in that quantum point contact?
No, sir. In few slides before, there was some plane. You showed that there was a histogram indicating a continuous distribution of size.
Oh yeah, the nano wall. Yeah, I'll show you. I'll show you again. This is actually made in Shiv Prasad's lab. This is the nano wall structure. Yeah, this one. You're talking about this one, right?
14, page number 14.
Yeah, this is the slide 14.
Yes, sir. No, sir, right? There was some blacks. Yes.
So this the material here, this is a top view. Okay, so imagine that there are these nano walls which are growing out of a substrate. Okay, so the substrate is, I think, sapphire here, and what they do is they are growing gallium nitride on top of that, and the gallium nitride is growing in the form of nano walls. Okay, so these walls are really sharp at the top, and they have a width of about, you can see here, this is 100 nanometer scale, so the width of these would be somewhere between 10 to 15 nanometers. Okay, but these are all voids. Yeah, actual voids. You're right, there are no atoms there. Okay, And in fact, it's surprising, gallium nitride is a semiconductor, okay? But it turns out these the top ends of these gallium nitrides are not only very good conductors, but it also turns out they have 1D conducting properties and they are also magnetic. Okay, they also have a strong magnetic response. So,
but seeing the picture, how can we say that it is strongly magnetic?
No, you can't say. Absolutely not. This is a real space image. What they have done on this is something called magnetic force microscopy. Okay, so using magnetic force microscopy, they could understand that there is a strong magnetization, a strong spontaneously formed magnetic moment on the top of these walls, because they could take this magnetic force microscope and hover it over the walls or in between the voids. Okay, and they found that the void does not have that response, whereas when the magnetic force probe was right on top of the walls, there was a strong magnetic response. Okay, so you need a different kind of a microscope to do that. You understand?
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. This is just a scanning electron microscope. And if you go, if you read some of his papers, then you can see that there are these high resolution transmission electron microscope images also, which show you that each of these walls is highly crystalline. Okay, this is not an amorphous system. This is a highly crystalline system. And the growth pattern is very unusual. Okay. Still, they have not found real applications for this, but it's very interesting. Only when you study its properties that can you design some applications. So studying its properties is very important. Okay, so
okay,
let's get back to understanding the quantum transport. And what I showed you was that there were certain subbands. So let me just go through it quickly. Let's say you have a source and a drain, and say a 1D conductor sandwiched between these two. Okay. So maybe a carbon nanotube or something. So this is the left electrode, right electrode. You could also call it source and drain. I have not drawn the gate here. Okay. So the gate is sort of assumed. So maybe you have gates here. So this is gate one and this is gate two, which is basically used for the confinement. Okay. And in this, if I draw the energy level picture, then what you can see is that the device here, okay, this is the nano device, which is sandwiched between these. The nano device has individual levels or subbands, right? And these subbands are arranged in some way with respect to the Fermi level of the left and the right. So this is the Fermi level, okay? But then when you apply the source drain voltage, then this could, for example, go up here and this could go down here. And there would be a potential difference between these two, okay? So this is mu L, chemical potential left, chemical potential R, right? And So if I extrapolate this here, then this here is the source drain voltage, VSD, okay? So the point is that this source drain voltage actually determines how many levels are going to do the transport, right? All the levels which are coming in between the mu L and mu R, those are the only ones that contribute to the transport, right? And how do you change that? You can change that in two ways. You can either change the mu L minus mu R, because if you go on increasing the mu R, the number of levels that are in between the mu L and mu R will change. But in practice, what experimentalists do is that they tune the gate voltage. So remember, there is a gate here. And by tuning the gate voltage, you can tune the separation between these levels, right? You can make these levels go farther by increasing the gate voltage, or you can make them come closer by taking the gate voltage to zero. Okay, so essentially you can tune the number of levels that are held between the mu L and mu R. And by doing that, you can find out the total current and by each subband. So the current of the ith subband, and that is given by E times integral mu R to mu L of di of e, okay, vi of e de. So what are we doing here? Remember, the current is basically given by NeV, right? This is the number of electrons, this is the charge, and this is the velocity. But then how to find this n, right? What this, how to find this n is this way. This is dE times dE is basically the total number of states within the energy interval dE. And V is the velocity corresponding to that particular energy level, right? So if I multiply this whole thing and integrate this from mu r to mu l, I get the total number of states, okay? So this I showed you last time was basically given by mu r to mu l 1 over pi times del E by del kz. Yeah?
Sir, each channel contributes same current, right?
That's correct.
Sir, then why we are using the suffix I, because it can say it can define that ith subband is giving I current.
No. So the thing is, see, there could be subtle differences between the density of states for each of the bands. See, remember, each of them is a subband. Okay. And in see, this is a very qualitative and a simple argument, where we will be taking a pure, say, parabolic density of states or a parabolic dispersion and using the free electron dispersion, right? So basically, we are saying that E is h cross squared by 2m, kx squared plus ky squared plus kz squared, okay? And we showed last time that the kx and ky are discrete and this is continuous, okay? So this becomes EI plus h cross squared by 2m kz squared, fine. So all we are saying here is that if you take the ith subband, then the reference energy would be different for it. That's all, okay? The constant that is determining the shift in this subband, that derivatives will all turn out to be the same because this constant will drop out. Is that clear?
So can you just repeat? I could not hear.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is, if you take the total energy, then the total energy is given by the energy of the subband plus the dispersion or the kinetic energy along the z direction. Okay. And this is continuous, whereas the EIs are discrete. This you remember from last time, right? The KX
yes.
and KY are discrete.
Yes, sir.
So the EI becomes a reference value and it determines what is the shift of this subband. Okay, so this particular DI of E and VI of E is written just to remind us what is the reference energy EI.
Okay, sir. Okay?
So, but when we calculate the density of states and when we calculate the VI, they will turn out to be identical for all the bands, because this reference energy will basically drop out. Okay, and this gives us exactly E by pi h cross times mu l minus mu r, which is just 2 E squared by h times u. Okay, so if I u is basically the VSD. So if I calculate the conductance I by u, I will get 2 E squared by h, right? And if there were n number of subbands, then this would just get multiplied by n, 2 E squared n by h. Okay, so each subband would carry a fixed amount of current, right? So this is very interesting because this is telling you that the conductance is actually quantized. Okay, you cannot have an arbitrary change in the conductance. Okay, if a subband, if a particular subband comes within the mu L and mu R range, then it will start conducting. And the conductance that it will contribute is exactly 2 E squared by H. Okay, it depends only on fundamental these universal constants. Okay, I didn't talk about what is the material, right? Silicon, carbon, I didn't talk about that. I did not talk about what is the size of this, right? Irrespective of all of those details, right? You get conductance quantization, which is very significant. Okay, you're seeing a universal phenomenon. So this was observed, as I showed you, in that quantum point contact. But that quantum point contact that I showed you in the talk was actually made using lithographic techniques. Okay, and lithographic techniques need a lot of care and clean room facility and so on. But then what if you go back to the textbook that I had referred to, this Ibach and Luth, which is what I'm going to show you now, they have shown a very different and a very nice, they have actually referred to a very nice paper where you see the same conductance quantization. This is conductance in wait, let me zoom in. Okay, so you see conductance squared by H, and again you see this quantization, you see these steps versus time. Okay, now why is there time here and why not source drain or, you know, the gate voltage and so on? To understand that, I will show you the paper that they have referred to. So let me see if that comes up. Yeah, it's this. okay. So there are two kinds of devices that these guys have considered, which act like point contacts. Okay. There is something called module 1 and there is something called module 2. In module 1, this place, okay, do you see the place where I'm circling? Can you all see the mouse?
Yes,
cursor? Yes. Yeah. So this place where I'm circling is actually the quantum point contact. Okay. And this device that they have considered is called a relay. Okay. And they have made two different relays. One is a commercial relay, this module 1, and this module 2 is a homemade relay. Okay. In their own lab, they had made it. And in this relay, what they can do is that this triangular shaped thing, if it touches this other contact, it means the contact has been made. Okay, and what they can do is they can tune the voltage very, very carefully so that they can move these two contacts away from each other as a function of time. Okay, that's why the time was there. And what you see here are these two wires. Okay, there is one wire here and another wire here, and there is a piezoelectric tube that is fitted here. And this piezoelectric tube can be moved by picometers. Okay, so in the piezoelectric, again, the piezoelectric phenomenon is a very interesting phenomenon where you can apply a voltage and create a mechanical response, right? Normally, we have seen when you apply an electric field, you get a current, right? Which means when you apply an electric field, you get a charge transport, you get charged response. But imagine applying an electric field and getting a mechanical response, right? That's what happens in the piezoelectric. So this black thing that you see with this shaded portion, that's actually a piezoelectric tube. And by applying an electric field, you can see that there is a double arrow that is shown here. You can either shrink the tube or expand the tube, okay, lengthwise. And this compression and expansion can be done with the resolution of picometers or tens of picometers, sub angstrom. So that's very interesting. And using that, they can either create or break the contact between these two wires. Okay, so that's quantum point contact for you, right? Using this particular arrangement, they could measure the data that was shown earlier in Ibach and Luth. That is this. This is the data. Okay, A and B. This B was basically the commercial relay. Okay, and they could see the a high degree of quantization up to 6 G naught. G naught is 2 E squared by H, right? That's the universal conductance. So, in fact, even in the quantum Hall effect, you see E squared by H appearing. Okay, but the reason in quantum Hall effect is very, very different. So the beautiful thing about quantum Hall effect is that the bulk actually in the 2D electron gas is not conducting at all. Okay, it's only the edge states, and topology plays a very important role in the quantum Hall effect. Whereas here, there is no topology. Okay, it's basically how many levels come in between the chemical potentials of the source and the drain. That is what controls the conductance. And the device that these guys have used is a conventional relay. Okay, there is no lithographic technique, there is no nanostructuring that has been done, and purely with a commercially available device, they could observe a quantum effect. Okay, so that was the beautiful thing about this. All right. Any questions? Okay, the other thing is this. It turns out that we have not incorporated any scattering at all in this system. Okay, so look at this. Okay, if you look at the current expression here, all we have is a density of states. We have the velocity here, but is there any relaxation time that we have incorporated? There is no relaxation time, right? Which means there is actually no scattering inside at all. Okay, and if there is no scattering at all inside the device, that is called ballistic transport. And the title of the paper which I showed you in that quantum point contact slide was actually ballistic transport. But there was a crossover from ballistic transport to diffusive transport because the suspended quantum point contact showed strong electron-electron interactions. And if you have strong interactions, then you will have scattering. And scattering will make the transport diffusive instead of ballistic. Ballistic means bullet-like, okay? For those of you who don't know, ballistic means bullet-like. So essentially, here you have ballistic transport, but still finite conductance, okay? And there is a very subtle reason to all this, but the finite conductance happens because there are these contacts, okay? And it's the contacts which actually introduce this quantized conductance. If you had only the device, then the device has ballistic transport, so which means that there is actually no limit. It's perfect conductor. Okay, and the resistance or the conductance is purely coming from the contacts. And there is a person called Supriyo Datta in Purdue University who has written a book called From Atom to Transistor. And he gives a very nice analogy in many of the talks that he has given on YouTube. So the analogy that he gives is, let's say there is a big highway, okay? And that highway leads to a flyover. Let's say the highway is a 10-lane highway, 5 lanes on each side. And the flyover is only 4 lanes, 2 lanes on either side. So from 5 lanes, the traffic has to get constricted to 2 lanes, okay? So naturally, there will be a buildup at the beginning of the flyover, okay? Even though there are no speed breakers or, you know, it's like perfectly aligned traffic, exactly at the beginning of the flyover, there's going to be a constriction. And this is something very similar that happens in these devices also, okay? Essentially, the transport inside this device is ballistic, okay? And you can assume that the left side metal and the right side metal are also perfect conductors. Right? Even then you will get a finite conductance because of the contacts. Remember, in the left side metal, there is a continuum of density of states. In the right hand side also, there is a continuum of density of states. Okay? But inside the device, there are only a finite number of channels available. Right? So these electrons have to squeeze in and then get onto these channels. Right? And because of that, there's going to be a contact resistance. And it turns out very beautifully that if you can confine only a few levels between these two chemical potentials, you will get a quantized conductance. Okay, so that's the origin of this quantized conductance. I would like to stop today and take up this Aronoff-Bohm effect and there's something called Altshuler-Spivak oscillations, which is a quantum interference effect. And something, it's actually an analog of the Young's double slit experiment for photons, okay? Which can also be understood in very simple terms using free electron theory. So, but that I'll take up tomorrow. If there are any more questions, I can try to answer those now.
Sir?
Yeah?
Sir, in nanostructure systems, the nanoparticles are not connected, always connected to each other. I think they are not. Then how we can visualize or how we can get the conductivity or more other phenomena?
No, very nice.
Maybe
Okay, asked a very nice question. See, there are two kinds of experiments which are done. One is you take, you build a system which has many, many nanocrystals packed together. Okay, so it's a nanocrystalline system, but not individual nanocrystals, but many, many nanocrystals put together. There what happens is that if you have all sizes and shapes of nanocrystals put together, then you will necessarily have hopping from one nanocrystal to the other nanocrystal. Okay, it's not going to be free transport. The other kind of experiment is where they take a single nanocrystal, okay, and they can build contacts to that single nanocrystal. In fact, not only a single nanocrystal, you can take a single molecule and build contacts to that. So let me show you a single molecule transistor. So this is a completely different kind of a system where you can take a single molecule, for example, like this, and sandwich it between two electrodes. Okay. So this in this experiment, you are probing the properties of a single nano system. It could be a molecule, it could be a nanotube, it could be a quantum dot, for example, or any other thing. But the other kind of system where you don't have the capability to make probes to a single molecule or to a single quantum dot, you take a bunch of nanocrystals, okay, make a pellet out of it or make a wire out of it, and then you probe its properties, where you have to incorporate many different processes, like grain boundaries will be there. There could be variable range hopping. In fact, there are something called granular superconductors, okay, which have very different properties than bulk crystalline superconductors. So does that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, if I did not answer, then you can repeat the question. You had a very meek yes.
No, sir. It's okay. And I have another question, sir. Suppose we are preparing a copper crystal, copper BCC crystal, maybe in total bulk crystal. Then, however we made it, it will form a BCC, and the total symmetry along the bulk system will be there. But when we prepare any nanocrystal, then there will be any, though they are ordered in few area, but when we make the material, then the periodicity is lost, and then it will be zigzag, I think. Then depending on...
No. Don't call that zigzag. What happens there is that the... the surface structure can be very different, first of all. Okay. Actually, it turns out, even if you take gold, for example, okay, gold has a bulk structure. But if you look at the surface of gold, okay, if you look at the surface of gold, the surface of gold can have a very different structure compared to the bulk gold. Okay. Similarly, if you take a nanocrystal of, as you said, copper, then there would be a crystalline structure, by which I mean, if you do X-ray diffraction, you will actually get very neat diffraction spots. Okay. But if you try to calculate the structure using retooled refinement or using other techniques and use bulk band structures as the initial guesses, you might not converge very easily. Okay. You will have to probably use, there are these molecular dynamics methods for optimization, there are density functional theory based methods for real space optimization that you will have to use as complementary techniques in order to arrive at the real space structure of these nanocrystals. It's not very easy. Okay, but it's not as you said, zigzag. So you can't even name it. Okay, there are structures which are specific to specific sizes. And you just have to, calculate them or visualize them and see them. So it's hard to give names to these.
Okay, sir. I understood.
Yeah. Okay. We'll meet tomorrow then.
Sir?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Can you please repeat what was the origin of the contact resistance?
The origin of contact resistance. Basically, what I'm saying is, if you look at the left and right electrodes, they are basically reservoirs. Okay, they are large systems, continuum systems. So the density of states is a continuous object. Okay.
Yeah.
Or you can say the spectrum is continuous. But if you look at the nano object, which is sandwiched between the electrodes, that nano device has discrete levels. Okay. And the analogy that Supriya Dutta gives is basically you go from a 10 lane highway to a 2 lane flyover, for example. Okay. Where all the cars in or vehicles in the 5 different lanes have to now converge onto these 2 lanes. So even though the transport is barrier free, resistance free along the 10 lane highway and along the 2 lane highway, when there is going to be a crossover from the 10 lane to the 2 lane highway, there is going to be a gap, there is going to be a barrier. Okay. Similarly, here also what is happening is the number of channels available for electron transport in the continuum are infinite. Okay, they are continuous. However, they become discrete inside the nano device. Okay. And this continuum to discrete crossover that happens at a very sharp interface between the device and the continuum is what is responsible for the contact resistance. Is that clear?
Okay. And what about the material property? They do not play any role.
They don't play any role. That's the whole point. It's just the number of electronic energy levels. That's the beauty of this. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, there is a slightly more general formalism called the Landauer-Buttiger formalism, which I can't introduce here, but once we do second quantization, I can introduce that. And there it's much more clearer because, see, right now what we did was we only focused on the device. Okay. We found out the independent device levels, the discrete device levels, and then we looked at the transport or the current carried by each of these individual levels. But what we can also do is to take into account the contacts as well and then treat the system as a whole. And even there you will see that phenomenon. It's exactly the same thing for the quantum Hall effect also. There also you can build MOSFETs using widely different materials, different geometries and so on. But topology plays such a strong role there that again you get quantized Hall conductance. Okay. So yeah, I mean, these are some really beautiful phenomenon where material properties don't matter and it's only some very universal properties that matter. Like how much current can an individual subband carry? Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, when we got the current for each subbands, suppose one electron is ballistically go from one position to another position through one subband, and while going from one position to another position by a subband, can there be electron-electron interaction between different subbands that
yes,
make resistance?
Correct. Absolutely. So that that paper on quantum point contact basically deals with this. See, we don't know whether the electron-electron interaction is between two different subbands. It is possible that electrons even within a single subband would be interacting strongly with each other. Okay, that is also possible. And if that happens, the dispersion that we have used, that is kz squared by h cross squared kz squared by 2m, will not be valid anymore. Okay. The free electron dispersion that we used is not valid anymore, and you have to incorporate many body effects in order to even calculate the current carried by individual subbands. You understand? So it's not necessary to have interactions only between the subbands. There could be intra subband interaction also.
That means the current is not fully ballistic always.
Absolutely, yeah. There is scattering inside. There is inelastic scattering that could be happening inside. In fact, one more thing that I did not mention was all of these experiments have to be done at very low temperatures because there was a good discussion on length scales in Ibach and Luth. So go back and look at it. There is something called an inelastic scattering length. There is something called an elastic scattering length. And there is something called a spin coherence length. Okay. See, basically, what we have assumed in all of this is that the electron retains its wave nature throughout and phase information is retained. Okay. So that can only happen if you do not have inelastic scattering. And if electrons scatter against phonons or other electrons, then that is going to be inelastic and it's going to destroy the phase information. Okay. So if phase information is destroyed, remember the particle in a box problem, when we solved the particle in a box problem, we had assumed plane wave solution. And the plane wave solution has a fixed phase, right? But if the phase is randomly changing within the box, then we can't use a plane wave solution. Okay, so the inelastic scattering definitely changes the phase, and the phase, the inelastic scattering length should be more than the device size in order to see these quantum effects. So that can also be done by decreasing the temperature, because by decreasing the temperature, you are basically changing the phonon number density, okay, or changing the electron phonon scattering cross section. And also by changing the electron density, you can control the electron-electron interactions. In fact, by tuning the confinement, you can tune the electron-electron interactions. Okay?
Okay, sir. I understand.
Okay. Okay. See you tomorrow then.
Bye, sir.
Yeah, bye.
Yeah, bye.